the bed. Spring corn has led. Feel like old Ned. Wish I was dead. All my life through, I've been so black and blue. Even the mouse ran from my house. They laugh at you and scorn you too. What did I do then to be so black and blue? Oh, I'm white inside, but that don't help my case. Cause I can't hide what is in my bed. How will it end? Ain't got a friend. My only sin is in my skin. What did I do to be so black and blue?
Armstrong found himself ultimately settling in New York with his fourth wife, Lucille, here in this neighborhood of Corona, Queens. At the time, Corona was populated by mainly Irish, Italian families with a small population of Blacks. The Black presence is in this neighborhood really brought a familiarity for the Armstrongs, and it encouraged them to stay in Corona. He fell in love with the neighborhood and the people. But I don't want you guys to take it from me. I'll let Lewis tell you.
So, wonderful world. There's a zillion people dug that tune the way I did it when I felt it. Because it's so much in wonderful world that brings me back to my neighborhood where I live in Corona, New York. Of course, Long Island, everybody know where that is. And Lucille and I. Ever since we married, we've been right there in that block. And everybody keeps their little homes up like we do. And it's just like one big family. I saw three generations come up in that block. Mm. And they're all with their children, grandchildren. They come back to see Uncle Satchmo and Aunt Lucille. So that's why I can say, I hear babies cry. I watch them grow. They'll learn much more than I'll ever know. And I can look at all them kids' faces. And I got pictures of them when they was 5, 6, and 7 years old. It is a wonderful world.
All right. Now that we've heard from Lewis himself, let's go into the first room of the house, the Armstrong's living room. For the most part, every part of the house remained untouched since Lucille passed in 1983. As we speak, the house is going through some much needed renovations and curatorial processing to make it look a little bit closer to the way it looked in 1970. This next photo is a shot of the Armstrongs in the same room in 1970. Lewis and Lucille moved into this house deeply in love, in a relationship based on fun and admiration for each other. In many ways, this living room is an international room. It contains souvenirs that the Armstrongs brought back from places all over the world. In this photo, Lewis and Lucille board a plane with an Ebony magazine in her bag. I'd like you guys to take a minute and write in the chat if you can identify what iconic civil rights leader is featured on the cover of that magazine. I'll give you guys a minute. Don't everyone answer at once.
I won't answer.
It's easy. Oh, I see the answers coming in. If you said Dr. King, Martin Luther King, you are correct. So it's from the 1986 issue of Ebony magazine where Dr. King was featured on it. And so that those types of wonderful experiences are how we see some of the support that the Armstrongs gave. Now, some of the items that you see in this living room and in this photo is the Severus vase given to Louis by the Prime Minister of France. This vase is only given to a handful of notable people. On the west wall of the living room, you can also see an oil portrait of Armstrong done by Calvin Bailey, an African-American artist from Los Angeles. Now, he created the painting based upon a famous photograph of Louis by Antoine Ruel, which appeared on the cover of Vanity Fair magazine. Louis is holding his trumpet and his trademark handkerchief. On the south wall of the living room is a beautiful oil portrait of Lucille Armstrong. The painting is by Samuel A. County, an African-American artist who lived in Long Island and who knew Lucille because his older sister was one of Lucille's friends. County studied at the School of and Museum of Fine Arts in Boston. The Armstrongs were patrons to many, and both shared a love for supporting others. Louis met Lucille when she was a dancer at the Cotton Club in New York City in 1938. She was the first dark-skinned dancer in the Cotton Revue and had already toured Europe by the time that she had met Louis. Here's a photo of Lucille and the Blackbird dancers. So Louis came from humble beginnings. During this time, many Blacks resided in low-income neighborhoods that sometimes were kept under rather harsh conditions. Nonetheless, these places retained a lively culture that we find also ingrained in Louis Armstrong. At the age of 12, Louis was sent to the Waif's Home for Colored Boys, a reformatory institute in Louisiana. He was given an undetermined sentence to serve for shooting a pistol on New Year's Eve. Only 7 years prior to Louis's arrest, young Black children were sent to adult prisons for violating the law. The Waif's Home was a former swamp rescued by visionaries in the community who sought the need to implement a reform school that would take Black children out of the dangerous criminal settings of prison and bring them into something a little more encouraging. It wanted to make them a functioning part of their communities and taught them carpentry, music, cooking, and Louis also speaks about. It was during his stay at the Waif's Home that Louis learned to play the cornet and to read music. Many elements of the music from the early 1900s and the culture of New Orleans influenced the way that Louis performed in the years to come. This next clip is Louis explaining how the Black community of New Orleans supported the young musicians from the Waif's Home.
Say, Sat, you were in some shootings down in New Orleans, weren't you?
Well, that was not deliberately.
No,
I mean,
but I mean,
celebrating.
Celebrating.
I mean, you got to explain yourself there, but you see about four people laying out there. You think we were shooting blanks, you know. And my old father's 38, you know, one of them old big barrel 38s from way back. My mother had been trying to hide this pistol, you know, and as other kids got them little six shooters, you know.
Yeah.
So we go around and sing in twos, you know, singing our theme song, like My Brazilian Beauty, and we hit Rampart Street. Well, in those days, on New Year's Eve, if you got a shotgun and anything, you just run in the backyard, boom, boom, boom. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Cop ain't there, you get away with it.
Yeah.
But here come this kid on the other side, he had a little six shooter. Die, 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 die. Well, he's having the ball. One of them said, get him, Dipper. They call me Dipper Mountain. You know? So I pull that big thing up. Yo, yo, yo. And after the fourth one, I felt somebody hugging me. That was the detective. Oil was coming in, just a boy 12 years old.
Yeah.
Oh, I cried. I cried. But I went right back there just the same.
As we transition through the home, we will highlight the beauties of the Armstrongs' home. This next room is their dining room, and today it features some Asian decor such as a faux bamboo china cabinet and a Chinese painting with characters that roughly translate to paradise on earth. These decor items were added by Lucille in 1977. The chandelier and mirrored walls are featured in the next photos. The Armstrongs often brought invited people over for great meals and conversations in these rooms. Some of Lewis's favorite dishes were those of his native home state of Louisiana. In this next clip, Lewis will talk about those early staple foods.
We're back there in the early days, and we didn't have much money or anything like that, but we lived, and like you say, I enjoyed good food.
You had a lot of fun?
Yeah, my mother could take 15 cents and go to the poultry market and come back and cook a meal. I mean, a big, and you had to lick your fingers, it's so good. You know what
for
I mean?
15 cents?
Yes, sir. In those days, you could take a newspaper and I'd go to the market, a fish market, and buy a whole newspaper full of fish heads. Just plain chopped off fish heads that they would use to put aside.
Yeah, well, that'd be garbage for them, wouldn't it?
Well, they just ain't got time to do what we did. Yeah. My mother would get the fish heads and take them home and cook them and clean them and cook them and put a lot of tomatoes, canned tomatoes in them and call it cubillon. It's a Creole dish and serve it on top of some rice. Boy, you talking about beautiful food and delicious.
No kidding.
Yes, and she could cook cabbage, red beans, and all that. And I remember we were so poor too, and healthy, because Mama always kept us physic-minded anyhow. You know.
Yeah.
Okay. So we could eat hobnails and wouldn't take sick. Mm-hmm. And the next morning I go to school with a cabbage sandwich.
Cabbage sandwich.
Cabbage sandwich and good leftover from last night.
Yeah.
Kids be begging for a bite.
No kidding.
Yes, you
do. Did you ever get any of that problem?
No.
No?
You don't do that, because the next morning I got a fresh stomach to start maybe a pork chop or something, or whatever.
For breakfast, the pork chop?
Anything we can eat for breakfast is all right with us. Glad to get it.
Now, we share one of the favorite rooms of the Armstrong house, the state-of-the-art kitchen, installed in 1970. It has a custom stove made by Crown with six burners, a double oven, and a double broiler. The lacquer aquamarine cabinets are actually made of wood and were created by a Brooklyn company called Kingsway. Other notable features of this kitchen are the built-in blender, electrical can opener, and swing top paper towel holder. We're going to begin to transition into the more private spaces of the Armstrong's home, their bedroom and the den. So later in Lewis's career, his health began to increasingly decline. We noticed that the image that there is a state-of-the-art electric chair that Lewis would sit on in the staircase. Armstrong's first heart attack was in 1959. And then 10 years later, in 1968 and 69, he suffered heart and kidney problems, followed by another heart attack in 1970 after a two-night encore performance at the Waldorf. His mobility through the spaces of his home began to become a little bit challenging, as you can see in the next photo. So we're going to go ahead and take this chair up with Lewis to his bedroom. This is the bedroom of the father of jazz. The silver foil wallpaper and lampshades are a reflection of Lucille's redecoration after her widowhood had begun. In the northern corner of the room, Lucille's sitting and prayer area, which was dedicated to Saint Martin of the Americas. It includes a Salvador Dali replication of the crucifixion and statues of saints, as well as Lucille's family Bible that reflected her Catholic beliefs. She worshiped at Our Lady of Sorrows Church that was just around the corner from the house on 37th Ave. This room that's coming up is the dressing room, and we find the same patterns we found in the main room of the silver mylar wallpaper from inside and out of the cupboards. Now, when Lewis and Lucille lived in this room, it would have been filled, lived in this home, this room here would have been filled with tuxedos, suits, gowns, furs, dresses, handkerchiefs, and even more, much of which were donated after Lucille's passing. although a few garments still hang there today, holding the Armstrong's memory, as seen in the next photo. Now, among these gowns is the photo that, among these gowns is a dress that belonged to Lucille, customed by a Florentine designer named Emilio Pucci. Now, I'm wondering, it's an interaction question for you all. Can anyone let us know who this iconic singer is embracing Lucille in this photo? You can go ahead and write that in the chat. We'd love it. Oh, we got him coming in quick. Any other takers? All right. We got people saying Ella, it is. It is. Ella and Lewis worked together to create three iconic albums, and their friendship Ella's friendship with Lewis and Lucille transcended the last few decades of their lives. In just a few moments, you'll hear one of these iconic songs. As we go back into one of the more private rooms and we return to the main room of the bedroom. So we walk virtually through this space and we see Lewis and Lucille sitting in what was their bedroom. We consider that Lewis spent his last moments of life in this room. He passed in his sleep 2 days after he celebrated what was believed to be his 71st birthday on July 4th, 1971. We later found baptismal records that indicated that Lewis was born on August 4th, 1901, instead of July 4th, 1900. In this next photo, we see scribed at the bottom of a Scotch brand recording tape from Lucille's own handwriting. It says, "The last tape recorded by Pops, July 5th, 1971. The next day, Louis Armstrong would pass away. Let's enjoy the last song recorded on this tape as we take a moment to remember Armstrong's life and the life of so many others during this interesting time.
Never missed a warm embrace till April in Paris. Whom can I run to? What have you done to
that was a clip from April in Paris that Lewis and Lucille recorded together. And it was the last song that he had ever heard. After Lewis died, Lucille received an overwhelming 20,000 letters of condolence. Lewis was adored and respected by many. And here we see a letter of condolence from Martin Luther King's widow to Lucille. It says Coretta Scott King. Lucille knew that Lewis was very connected with his fans, and if he had the opportunity to reply to all those letters himself, he would have. With the help of Phoebe Jacobs, she responded to every letter. It took about 3 years and some extra hands, but the job was achieved. In this next newspaper clipping from about 6 weeks after Lewis's passing, Lucille speaks of her plans for Lewis's legacy and their home of 28 years. She says, "It is so many beautiful memories, 28 years of happiness. It was the only home he'd ever owned. He used to say it was the home he dreamed about when he was in the Waif's home in New Orleans." It also states that all of Lewis's things are there. "I'm going to keep them there. Eventually, I'll probably give them to the city as a memorial to Lewis. We had planned to do that. People could start to come and see the place where Lewis lived." Now, as we begin to transition into Lewis's prize space and the final room of the tour, I hope that we have allowed you all to experience the home the way that Louis and Lucille would have wanted you to. Now we find ourselves in the den. This is the room where Louis spent numerous moments with friends, musicians, as well as some joyous times alone. He was always hands-on with his hobbies, whether it be typing, collaging, or playing his trumpet. So today, enjoy the presence of each other, as well as these faces and these beautiful things we'll see and hear about Louis. Now, having a den or a man cave is probably every man's dream. For Louis, this room was all Lucille's idea. In this next clip, we'll hear him tell you the story.
Start with it. Index. So I index all the numbers and give them a number. And then my Lucille fixed something I never had in my life before. She gave me a room and made a den out of it. You know what I mean? That really knocked me out because we couldn't afford no den in them early days. We better sleep in that room.
Now you just got a den.
Now I got a den. I look at all my tapes around the walls and just pick out what I want to hear.
How does it feel?
Well, it's got to feel good. I mean, I don't ask much in life. I mean, those are the needed things. She know that would be my life in music. So when I can hear every record I ever made, all I got to do is look in a little book and put my finger on it. My interviews, I got them all on tape, and I buy records.
Now, like Louis's strong support for others, I feel like it was a reflection of the way that he supported himself. In 1931, Louis returned to New Orleans for the first time in 9 years, performing and broadcasting in front of an all-white audience at the Suburban Gardens. Despite the fact that Louis was recognized in many faces in the room, some of whom he had grew up alongside, he was determined to leave his heart on that stage, but right before the broadcast, the station's white announcer refused to introduce him. Louis experienced brutal racism, even at the top of his career. His reaction was to look for common ground and create transformative collective experiences on stage. Here's Louis narrating these events. This next clip contains explicit language. Please be wary.
You know, I'd been away about 9 or 10 years, and I done got northern fire, I done forgot about a whole lot of that foolishness down there, you know. But this night, they done propped this man up to just a big deal. Now you bring on Louis Armstrong, he's a New Orleans boy, and blah, blah, blah. So I'm straight, you know, all the boys said, this is nice. But a second before this cat had to go to that mic and bring me on, he walked away and said, I just can't introduce that nigga. Can't do it. Anyhow, they come to me and say, told me what he says. I said, well, don't worry about it. You know? I said, give me a card, boys. And I walked to that mic and ta-da, shim. And I walked to that mic. And before I opened my mouth, there's all the white boys that I was raised with. You know, sitting up there, sharp. Done got rich, maybe their fathers done left them the produce places and different things. They were, when we was kids, we'd hang around, and after school, we'd go out in the lots and play cowboys and Indians with old broken slates and things like that. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. We was the Indians. Oh, yeah, we might as well. And I've stood there 20 minutes, and they hollering, Dipper! Such, blah, 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 blah. And when I went into Pale Moonshine, man, you thought the walls was coming in. And this announcer standing there, you say, well, I didn't know this would happen in the South, in New Orleans. It never happened before. So they fired him and everything, and I took over myself.
Louis's abilities as a trumpeter, singer, and all-around entertainer made him a natural on the radio. 6 years after the Suburban Garden incident, Lewis made history when he became the first African-American to host a nationally sponsored network program in 1937, when he starred on the Fleshman Yeast Hour. His presence on the radio marked a tremendous breakthrough for African-Americans who were previously prohibited from these platforms. This milestone, in a sense, celebrates the fearless spirit that jazz and other Black music art forms represent. And to believe that, you probably just need to hear Lewis and his band as they perform I've Got a Heart Full of Rhythm on the Fleshman Yeast Show.
The makers of Fleshman Yeast bring you another fast and furious program featuring music by Louis Armstrong, the trumpet king of swing, and now the head gate himself, Louis Armstrong and his orchestra.
Now look here, got no shoes on my feet. I ain't got nothing to eat, but I've got a heart full of rhythm. Not a dime to my name, but I'm rich just the same. I've got a heart full of rhythm. When the skies look gray and everything's wrong, I find my way by singing a song. Let the great think I'm small, boy, I can laugh at them all. I've got a heart full of rhythm. Look at y'all. Now, folks, this is old Satchamouth swinging at you, playing one of them old good ones he wrote himself. A heart full of rhythm, yes.
Part of our 2020 gala, we had the opportunity to tell the story of Lewis and how he engaged with the civil rights struggle. We'd like you all to sit back, relax, and enjoy. Listen to our director, Regina Bain, and archivist, Ricky Riccardi.
On a fall day in 1957, 9 Black students arrived at the all-white Central High School in Little Rock, Arkansas, to begin classes, but were instead met by the Arkansas National Guard and a threatening mob. Photographs of the confrontation spread across the country and drew national attention. And then, on September 17th, 63 years ago to the day, a reporter sneaks into Louis Armstrong's dressing room, and Louis consents to an interview. To tell us what happens next, here's Ricky Riccardi.
While the events in Little Rock were unfolding, Louis Armstrong was out in the Midwest touring with his integrated band, the All-Stars. When he approached Grand Forks, North Dakota, he was asked for an interview by a young student reporter named Larry Lubinow. Armstrong thought it was going to be a regular interview, and Lubinow himself had been told, no politics.
And then I asked Louis if he knew that he was staying in the hometown of Judge Ronald Davey, who made the decision on Little Rock, and he said he didn't. Then he went off.
He had some strong words for people in the U.S. government then, didn't he? What did he call Governor Faubus?
He said he's a no good mother.
And he probably didn't mean mother. I see what you mean.
No, he
said President Eisenhower has no guts to let Faubus run the country. He said that the way they're treating my people in the South, the government could go to hell. Lubinow leaves Armstrong's hotel room, and he knows he has a front page news story. But his editor said, no, 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 no. There's no way that Louis Armstrong, yeah, the beloved Ambassador Satch, there's no way he said that. Lubinow ends up back at Armstrong's hotel room. Armstrong's in the middle of shaving, tells Lubinow to put the story on the wall. While he's shaving, he reads every word, writes solid on the bottom, photographer takes the photo, and the next day it's front page news around the world.
They've been ignoring the Constitution. Although they taught it in school, but when they go home, their parents tell them different. Say you don't have to abide by it because we've been getting away with it 100 years.
Now, the interesting thing is, for years, Armstrong had been criticized, and many in the jazz world thought of him as kind of a relic, somebody who was not in touch with the civil rights movement. And many, such as Sammy Davis Jr., Adam Clayton Powell, spoke out against Armstrong. Eisenhower had been criticized by many for not intervening sooner. 1 week after Armstrong's words, he finally sent in the army to make sure the 9 African-American students entered the school peacefully. Armstrong was thrilled, even sending Eisenhower a congratulatory telegram. In his mind, the controversy was over. But in the weeks that followed, Armstrong's TV appearances were boycotted, people boycotted his concerts, his records. He was due to appear on 2 major CBS television spectaculars, and both the sponsors said, you know what, we don't think it's smart to put Louis Armstrong on live TV right now. And it was actually Bing Crosby who said, if you don't have Louis Armstrong, then you don't get Bing Crosby. And in the middle of his trumpet solo, Armstrong had a very, very definitive message for anyone who said that Armstrong should not be the one to speak out for his country. In 1969, Armstrong was in intensive care at Beth Israel Hospital. In a very dark place, he began composing a private manuscript in which he vented his feelings about how he had never been properly appreciated for what he had done, specifically mentioning his comments on Little Rock. But when he came back in 1970 to celebrate his 70th birthday, there was this outpouring of love from Miles Davis, from Ornette Coleman, from the younger guard of African-American musicians. And at the Newport Jazz Festival, Armstrong's 70th birthday was celebrated by musicians young and old. Dizzy Gillespie, who was Armstrong's most vocal public critic for many years, admitted publicly that after Armstrong spoke out against Little Rock, his view of the trumpeter changed. The two of them were neighbors in Corona, Queens, and Dizzy began spending more time with Armstrong.
If it weren't for him, it wouldn't be any of us. So I'd like to take this moment to thank Mr. Louis Armstrong for my livelihood.
He had been asked by many reporters in interviews, what did he think about a certain particular thing? And Louis would say, well, man, you know, I'm just a musician. He never would come out publicly because his theory was that what I say carries a lot of weight. And he says, and I just won't do it. But at home, he had his opinions. And he was well averse on everything. He was well up on everything that was happening, both abroad and at home.
After Little Rock, he refused to speak out on these subjects publicly. But today, nearly 50 years after he passed, it's a completely different story. And the main reason is because of Louis Armstrong himself. By maintaining a personal archive, Armstrong made sure that he would be in charge of telling his own story to future generations.
The year was now 1965, and it introduced a pivotal time in the civil rights movement. It marked the year of the violent attack on peaceful demonstrators in Selma, Alabama, and the passing of the Voters' Rights Act, allowing African Americans the equal right to vote in the United States. After the infamous Bloody Sunday in March 1965, Lewis appears on the paper stating that they would beat Jesus if he was Black and marched. The episode motivates Lewis to bring back a hit that he hadn't performed in years. Black and Blue. On the 1965 night in East Berlin, Germany, he reworded the previous 1929 version. The original lyrics said, "I'm white inside," and were changed to, "I'm right inside," signifying Lewis's stance against the life-threatening treatments of Blacks in America. Lewis wasn't speaking publicly about these things, but he was listening, documenting every thought about the matter, and he was pouring it into his music and his feelings about the injustice. But most importantly, he was optimistic about the promise of citizenship and believed in integration as his generation thought that it was the revelation and the revolutionary idea of the century. Watch as he performed this significant version each night on tour of the Ironclad.
Yes, I'm right inside, but that don't help my case. Cause I can't hide what is in my face. But don't it, but it, that does I say, how would it end? Ain't got a friend, my only sin is in my skin. What did I do to be so black and blue?
Now, although Lewis was not the face of the civil rights movement, he utilized his music to stand by the efforts of freedom. Black and Blue were also performed in front of the first prime minister of Ghana, Kwame Nkrumah, and an audience of more than 20,000 people in Lewis's African tour in 1956. This concludes our virtual experience in recognition of Black History Month and Lewis's relationship with the civil rights movement. We hope that this experience has shown you a perspective of the life and legacy of Louis Armstrong that you may not have known previously. But we want to let Lewis close you out.
That's my story, folks. I guess I'm stuck with it. I usually say nice things also about human beings if they deserve it. I never want to be any more than I am. And what I don't have, I don't need it anywho. I've always loved and I always lived a normal life, which I appreciate very much. And I've always loved everybody, still do.